Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Seema Menon. I'm the director and CEO of CFO Collective, the organization that owns the CFO India brand, which is a leading media platform focused at engaging the CFO community in India. I'm delighted to welcome you all to the interaction today. We are excited to kickstart the discussion for today, which is second in the series of our newest initiative, which is a collaborative program with intelligent automation experts, Automation Anywhere. It's called CFO Diaries. Now, CFO Diaries is a playbook specifically curated for CFOs to help understand the ever-evolving scope of automation. The series aims to provide CFOs and business leaders with a toolkit of validated insights, peer experience to leverage automation to further their business goals, and optimally combine people and technology to ensure that the automation efforts fully meet the organization's expectations. It also serves as a platform to recognize automation forerunners and chronicle the success stories of CFOs who've championed the automation agenda within their enterprises. Now, what is the CFO Diaries initiative in the sense that what does it comprise? It comprises a set of virtual, intimate, thought-provoking interactions with finance leaders and experts to discuss and deliberate on various aspects of automation in finance and their vision for the road ahead. So after the resounding success of the first session, we are furthering the agenda on automation in today's interaction. To get started, I'm absolutely delighted to welcome our esteemed contributors for today's session. We have with us Anil Randhir, CFO, L&T Infotech, Abhilasha Sharma, Navigator, IKEA India, Vikas Surekar, Global CFO, StarTech, A. Venkatraman, Director and CFO, Grandforce India, Amit Bedi, Vice President Finance, Bain & Company, T. Praveen, CFO, Muthoot Microfin, Amit Agarwal, CFO, JK Fenner India, Bharati Karunanidhi, CFO, Mahindra World City Developers, and Milan Seth, Executive Vice President, IMEA for Automation Anywhere. So thank you everyone for joining us today. May I invite Milan Seth to just welcome our speakers for today's interaction before we just get started?
It's a pleasure to join the second CFO Collective. I think the whole theme when we started the CFO Diaries is to just share how CFOs are taking leading pole position in organizations to drive productivity, not just within the finance function, but beyond in post-pandemic period. And hence, this conversations and conversations like these are great to hear from all of you in your organizations. What are the key drivers and how technology can enable, support, drive, the readiness for the new world. So, I'm really looking forward to a exciting conversation with all of you.
Thank you so much, Milan. As you're all aware, this is a closed group interaction and we do not have an external audience listening to us. So that the larger finance community benefits out of this interaction, what we plan to do is record the session and edit it before we disseminate it to the community. And like I said earlier, this is a series that we've curated to help CFOs understand, embark on the journey and scale their automation efforts. So with that, we move into the interaction for today. For finance leaders, robotic process automation or RPA is emerging as a top priority because it enables companies to use software exclusively for repetitive tasks, including those associated with accounts payable, budgeting, and forecasting, all of which have traditionally been the responsibility of finance teams. However, to ensure employee buy-in and success of your RPA implementation, it is imperative to start by identifying the limitations in your current processes and assessing the areas where RPA can best support your teams. Companies that have reaped the benefits of deploying RPA have looked at automating routine tasks, not just as a means to reduce costs, but also as an opportunity to enable their finance teams to focus on strategic endeavors through which they can elevate the value of the finance function. So in today's session, we discuss how successful finance teams approach adoption of RPA differently to achieve better and sustainable results. So to get started, I would be keen to get a perspective first from Milan. Milan, tell us, within the finance function, where do you think the most impact will be made by RPA in the near future?
I think the largest number of deployments we have in the world, almost 500,000 plus bots are in the finance function. So finance is relatively one of the first functions which starts looking at it, predominantly for two reasons. These are rule-driven transactions, largely in finance, both because of policies as well as controls perspective. And the second is finance also, depending on the size of the organization, tends to have large number of volume internally or externally with suppliers, with at times even in a large services companies like StarTech, with employees and so on. So those are the kind of, you know, reasons why finance automation has kind of taken shape. You know, if I really look at more from a process lens, Seema, procure to pay and order to cash are the probably the simplest cycles which we've seen organizations start with. But then also there is, you know, record to report, hire to retire. There are many such cycles which are kind to look at it. And then one more dimension we have seen is vis-a-vis ERP. Organizations obviously have core SAP or Oracle as the backbone of running all the record of transactions. But when it comes to interactions within the organizations, depending on the industry, is where the automation kind of come into play. And probably one more element which I would love to add here, particularly in the Indian context, is the amount of documents which typically one manages in forms of PDFs, emails, service requests, and how do you integrate that in your process automation so that you have an end-to-end efficiency as well as effectiveness. That's a kind of a very big picture, and I'm sure we'll double click onto it as we proceed ahead.
I think that's a great start, Milan. Thank you so much for, you know, those opening comments. May I just request all our contributors to just come on video so that we have, you know, everybody joining in. Yeah, Amit, you had a point. Could you elaborate on that, please?
I just want to make a small point, but you know, broadly the way we frame it, like what needs to be automated. The way we look at it is internally is anything which is standard, manual, logical, and repeatable, right? Should not be done by human beings. It has to be automated. It has to be done by machines. And the thumb rule which we follow in all our internal departments, all our processes, to make sure that we are not wasting on all these things which are standard, manual, logical, and repeatable. That's just one minor point I want to make to begin.
Sure. Anil, I want to sort of get your input on this. You know, when you're talking about RPA or automation as an initiative, obviously, you know, it needs to be an initiative that is sort of very strategically aligned with your function and your business. So tell us, when you embarked on RPA implementation, how did you ensure that it fit well into the strategy for the function and for the business?
Thanks, Seema. I think for us, our strategic goal was also, you know, more of digital transformation, you know. Moving away from, you know, basically more from manual efforts, how can we automate, maybe it could be processes, it could be, you know, certain actions which are more repetitive in nature, or certain actions which are actually taking a long amount of time, you know, in terms of getting any kind of reports or statements, for which due to non-availability of those informations, a lot of decisions were being held up, you know. So ideally, we have embarked on that journey in terms of, you know, deploying RPAs, and we have seen, you know, in terms of it really fits into our strategy, where we are also seeing a lot of, you know, major cost savings which are coming in. The accuracy is much, much higher, much better, I would say. Actually, this is more of an evolving area where, you know, as and when we are looking into other areas, we are looking where we can deploy these kind of robots and where these can be synchronized our processes. And where we can link it. And ideally, one of the important thing is this entire process has a lot of greater resilience. You know, like for example, if I have to do a certain action, you may require additional set of people. You have to go into the market, hire them, look at their capabilities. But maybe when we look at RPA, it is basically developing a robot and just shooting it, you know, and you can use it as many times as much possible, you know, and it gives an accurate set of results. Plus it improves your productivity and compliance. So it actually fits into all the corners where there is a requirement from an organization perspective and strategy perspective.
Thanks, Anil, for that point. You know, I want to go next to Amit Agarwal. You know, Amit and I were having a conversation yesterday, and he was giving me a perspective of, you know, how RPA implementation was sort of just taking shape within his organization. So I think one of the thumb rule is to be able to streamline your processes before you automate them. I think that's the thumb rule. But there is, you know, another thought process which says that, or there is a dilemma which says, should organizations first automate the processes and fix the process steps on a need basis, or should they fix the processes, understand what can be automated, and then embark on automation? So Amit Agarwal, what is your input on this? And how did you do it within your organization?
Actually, I'm the strong votary of first fixing the processes. Actually, they are full of thoughts. You discuss the people, you know, it can go hand in hand also. You have both consultant and IT guys working together. But I'm of the strong view that you should first fix your processes, actually. You should know the process design. I mean, the gaps which are there should be fulfilled before you embark on any RPA journey, actually. Because what happens, unless you stabilize your processes, actually, your automation won't entail the desired result, actually. So your design or the process should be very clear. Process mapping, design, all those things should be very, very clear before you undertake any RPA exercise, actually.
Okay. Does anybody want to, have a different view or would like to add to this?
Yeah. So I think, you know, what Amit said makes sense in the sense that, of course, you need to have a standard process. You need to have a clarity in terms of who does what before you kind of automate it, right? But one thing one needs to be always careful is, you know, nothing is set in stone. Your processes that manage the business today will evolve. The business also will evolve later. And therefore, the rules that you need to manage also will change, right? So therefore, my view is, while the point is valid, which is make sure your process is robust, standardized before you go on automation journey, one can also look at it slightly more simplistically, in the sense that while you worry about the overall process to be standardized, there are many sub-processes which are very rules driven, right? If you have clear rules, and the rules are kind of sacrosanct, right? You can pick up those set of processes and try to see if high volume kind of justifies you to like start a automation journey or implement a bot, right? And then spread it across the larger process. For example, if I take, you know, order to cash cycle, right? If you take the cycle, there's opportunity for you to like just worry about, at least in our industry, how do you capture efforts? How does effort gets captured into billing inputs, right? That is fairly standard once you understand the various contract structures. So you can start there and then try and see, you know, how can you extend that entire automation and bot journey to the entire superset of the process. So that's another input I had.
So Milan, where do you stand here? That you partner with many organizations.
Yeah, I would add one more dimension to both what Amit and Vikas said, is that there's also an added element of data. So what happens is that a process, if it is in an SAP or an Oracle equivalent, then I think, you know, probably both the gentlemen said, I fully agree that standardize the processes. But what happens in real life, if you take a O2C or a P2P, you know, if I take Vikas's industry, for a timesheet system, data will come from an external system and then it will get into ERP. If I look at, in a manufacturing company, a supplier, invoices will come, which is an external data input, comes into play. So I think while you standardize the processes, it's very difficult for organizations to standardize the input data which you get from your suppliers, from distributors and whatnot. And hence, it's nice idea too that we should standardize the process, but it's always not possible. Generally, what we have learned, I kind of agree with Vikas's point that you have 10 steps in a process, and if there is a large volume, you at least automate step number, 3 to step number 8. Increase the throughput of that process or yield of that process. And if possible, if you can automate that step 1 to 10, even better. But when you have volume and when you are able to automate that, I think it just gives you a faster return. And maybe a small point when we talked about data and we talked about process is also the time and speed. You know, as Vikas said, in pandemic, we have observed that a lot of organizations rolled out quote unquote exception processes very quickly. And again, you cannot really, do an exception processes. And so that's where you use some of the automations to kind of accelerate your your adoption and penetration in the organization?
Right. I think the other question that is that sort of came up in my discussions with CFOs is, what's the best practice in terms of who should lead the RPA project? And Abhilasha, I wanted to get your inputs on this. And who do you think ideally should lead the RPA project? And why do you think he or she is sort of an ideal choice to lead the initiative?
I think when we talk about automation, especially in an organization, the first fear amongst the employees is, oh, this will impact my job. Once, you know, everything will be automated, I might not have my job anymore. So I think it should not be any position which should lead this process. It should be the mindset of the people who should lead this activity. And when I talk about mindset, I think, you know, some of the things that we need to think about while selecting a person for this role is that he should be, you know, willing to consider the stretch assignments or new assignments. He should have bent of mind to actively use the new technology in order to expedite or make the work efficient, and should be interested in unconventional ways of doing the financial activities in an organization. And the most important, as I said, is no fear of losing the job should be there. Mm-hmm. Having said that, I think this is more about having one person from each and every key process who can, and the key process could be forecasting, as you said, financial data analytics, anything related to the technical accounting, internal controls, picking people from these processes, and then they are reporting to the CFO, so that CFO has the entire idea of where we are going on the digital transformation path in the organization, and he can also define some of the priorities that maybe do. As Milan says, that when there are 5 or 10 steps, we do 3 to 10, rather leave 2 steps. So if we are involving CFO, he could give a better direction in terms of where the higher volumes are and what could be the places where there would be more requirement of RPA. Having said that, I think the bigger benefits that we will have to select these kind of candidates is that they will have the knowledge of these key processes, because and then we will achieve the focused approach. Then there is no change in the cost of the finance function, because we are picking these people from the function only, and we are asking them to devote their 1 hour or 2 hour within a particular week to get into automation. They will have a better job satisfaction for sure. And when they are designing the product from the start, they will also have a digital competence. So we are also building a digital competence in each and every process. As I said, they will also have the knowledge on the ways of working. And then these people can also be used in the BAT when we are doing business acceptance testing for these process automations. So that is my view, and I will also reflect on one of my experience into digital transformation. And I was involved in finance digital transformation during my stint in Genpact. However, there were like AVPs who were giving this task for each and every the AVPs who are the owners of P&L had the task to devote some of the time on the digital finance transformation. But the issue was that since the role in AVP was a little higher, and then there are some times that people are not able to join these calls because of the work pressure. So, if they would have selected people who are interested from each of the department, I think the time period and the process would be more robust and efficient, and they would have got, better material to work on.
Right. Thanks, Abhilasha. Anil, so I think one of the inputs that Abhilasha shared was looking at process owners to sort of drive the initiative. But, as in any organization, once you're sort of embarking on an initiative, you have a center of excellence created where you draw in a pool of people who are sort of heading specific processes. But, what's your take? Do you think it should be head by process owner, or should it rest with IT? Or a combination of two?
I think what Abhilasha said was that, there needs to be a team which needs to implement this entire process. So my view is, when you're talking about implementation of these processes in finance, I would say, CFO needs to be the sponsor of these projects. he needs to take that ownership, and obviously a team needs to be formulated under him. There will be people who will be coming from maybe say process excellence point of view, from an IT point of view, or an automation team which would be there. Plus there would be people who would be there from a finance point of view. Also maybe at times if the process is quite complicated and large enough, you will require people from internal control team or internal audit team to review it before it goes. Ideally, once the team is set up and there are reviews which happen periodically to assess where we are in terms of the process or the progress of this project, is where you determine whether it has been done or not. And I think the key also here is to be, many times, from my experience, I've seen that people embark on that project and suddenly you find bottlenecks that, we didn't anticipate any kind of, a hardware requirements or a particular software requirements when we planned it out. So I think the business case needs to be very, very, very clear. It needs, because if it is not justifying that kind of automation, doesn't make sense. So it starts from that complete, you have a complete business case with requirements, you have a team with a proper sponsor, with reviews, and then the implementation also.
Sure, great. Amit, Bedi, I want to go to you next. As with any initiative, there are multiple risks that are associated with RPA adoption, and how can these be mitigated?
So, broadly, there are five risks I can think of. One is one is not having a clear strategy at the beginning of the, project. It should not be seen as a cost reduction or the FTE reduction project, right? It should be like, you need to reimagine the whole process and the way it's going to work in future, and then get everyone together, right? It's just the overall having a wrong strategy at the beginning of the project. That's a wrong foot to start with. That's one. Second, I would say, RPA is just the sourcing, right? Do you want to do it internally or externally? I've seen many people who shy away from getting external, specialists, I would say. Don't shy away. Cut the chase, get these specialists, ask them for help, and get them sooner. The sooner you get them, more at the planning stage, the better it is. Don't get them late, right? Third, I would say stakeholder management. The point which Abhilasha was also making, that, you need 100% alignment on what you're going for, how you're going for, and why you're going for, right? Changing the, stakeholder management can get tricky at many times, right? So, aligning with your board, if board is sponsoring that, different internal department, that's very critical. Getting right IT support, getting, right process owner support, that's also very, very important. I think the most important is impacted employees. Look, it's a sensitive topic, right? And processes, it's very close to their heart. They want to do the way they have been doing. So they don't want to change the way, process is going to look 5 years online or 2 years down the line. So it's a bit sensitive when you're dealing with the employees who are getting impacted. And the fourth risk, I would say, the overall project risk, right? So you need to have sufficient buffer in terms of time and cost. Who knew that COVID is going to be there? It's just unforeseen. So have right amount of buffers in terms of time and cost to do it. And one risk in related to project implementation is around MNC angle. Like, when you're doing RPAs, one of the things I've experienced is a lot of MNCs, the head office don't understand the India complexity, right? Be it GST or other finance stuff, right? Reconciling GST on airlines, or there are multiple processes which, global, the headquarters won't understand. So make sure that the head office, especially relevant for MNCs, make sure the head office understands the India complexity in it. The last thing I would say is the post-implementation risk, right? You have right SLAs, right contracts with the external agency you're working with, right penalty clauses as well if things don't go well, right? And also, it's not a one-time, one-off activity. It's a continuous process which will keep on going. So There need to be a post-implementation support as well, right? So, I can think of these five risks which you need to think about relevant to your business and also mitigate earlier in the process. Keep a close eye on regular basis.
Right. Thanks, Amit. Venkat, I want to go to you next. So tell us about, RPA implementation within your organization, and, what are some of the benefits that you have seen trickling in?
Yeah, thanks, Sima. In fact, we are a multinational company. In fact, it is spread over 60 countries. So we were finding very difficult on the processing time, and because a lot of manual process, particularly on the exchange rate fluctuations, as well as the stock valuations and things like that. It took a lot of time, manual labors. In fact, our team have to spend 2 days only for this. So what we have done is we have put a automated process whereby during the night times it runs and then complete the job on the last working day, and then so that first working day you get the results from the finance side. As well as another factor from the finance side is we have spent a lot of time on the dashboard. In the sense is it took a lot of time to get the reports and things like that. So we have prepared the dashboards where the reports have come in, started coming. So the middle layer management time actually have minimized quite a bit. Mm. And coming to the customer side, what we have faced is since we have spread over on pan-India basis, a lot of our sales engineers were facing difficulties in capturing the data on customers' visits as well as opportunities and pipelines and things like this. So we put a strong, robust process wherein we could be able to capture when the last visit made and what was the purpose. So the transition of replacement of people also happens very quickly because of this automation. And the third is, since we are belonging to the pump industry means it's a service organization. So we could not reach to the many people. There are million people using their pumps. So if they have a problem, how they can fast? So we have an automated process through an app we have built, and then people can reach out fast, and then also complete as well as resolve, as well as the workflow approval. All these things we built in the app itself. Coming to the production area, wherever there is a less manual intervention is required, we have put a robotics as well as, so that the packaging and the assembly can go very well. So 30% of our workforce has got reduced. So these are all the few initiatives. Of course, the payroll is another initiative which we have undertaken, and then that is also become an automated process. And the I think people also, the previous speakers touched upon the forecasting, because forecasting is time consuming exercise. From we actually forecast not just 12 months, we just go beyond 12 months till 24 months. So what could be the history of data, how the analytics can help us based on analysis. So these are all the few things really help us on the.
Thanks Venkat. Milan, I want to go to you next. We have few people representing the manufacturing vertical here. I know BFSI is another use case that you could perhaps share. So tell us, some of the best use cases maybe from BFSI and manufacturing that you'd like to share in the group.
I think I would talk about particularly in finance as a whole, because we have a cross section here from retail to manufacturing. See, one of the things we have noticed is that typically, I'm assuming all the organizations will either have ERP, either SAP, Oracle, JD Edwards, one of those leading providers. There is a study that roughly around 40% of the processes still stays outside ERP, particularly HR to finance, supply chain to finance, sometimes even customer to finance function. And those are the use cases I think we've seen the most, which gets automated. The second area is particularly around on the order to cash cycle, where you are incorporating multiple data points. So you are either taking information from Salesforce or a CRM, then you are massaging the data and you're kind of putting it forward into the transaction system. I think P2P is one area where there is a large degree of automation. There are so many softwares available. If it is already in a shared services organization format where your finance is operated in a shared services mode, there are lots and lots of use cases, whether it's record to report and per se. One thing we've learned with manufacturing companies is the way you look at automation beyond, I think, I don't know whether Vikas mentioned it or was it Anil or Venkat? I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that point around the entire MIS related play. So you have multiple entities, you are doing consolidation. You have IFRS or US GAAP reporting. You know, you have treasury related operations, you have GST related operations. Now, even few years back when we started, we used to go saying, okay, out of 100 people in finance, 60 are in P2P or O2C, so let's automate that. But the real value, the effectiveness we have found, you know, is on some of those areas. I think somebody mentioned about compliance. So you have a large, you know, compliance related activities where you are, where earlier you were in, earlier you were doing a 10% sampling. Now you could do 100% sampling. So in finance, I think what you're finding is a very imaginative, having understood the possibilities of the systems, they're really putting it to amazing kind of use cases. You know, I can talk about one is the entire budgeting process, where when each of the functions give you a handshake and that iterations happens, and then when the budget gets rolled up before it touches the finance, again automation kind of comes into place. I can go on, and there is a lot of material available, but I'm just trying to sense that, you know, finance leaders, having understood the limitations and the possibilities, both, you know, come into play. One more small point I wanted to mention, I know we have not touched it so far, so more of a comment. A lot of CFOs are now realizing the value of cloud and how you can put some of these bots. I think, is that can you really get your new age finance processes straight away on cloud, incremental processes or automating that process? So that's another completely new dimension I see happening with, where the automation can reside on cloud, it can straight away automate your digital processes and digital interactions.
Yeah, I think that's a great input. Vikas, I want to go to you next. You know, you spoke a little bit around processes being fluid at times. So tell us, you know, what are some of the, or how do we sort of handle frequent process and technology changes post an RPA implementation? Because, you know, you said there could be exceptional processes which are not part of your regular, you know, day-to-day kind of work. So in these kind of scenarios, how do you think, you know, we can handle some of those changes?
Great question, Sima. I think probably a difficult one to answer as well, because there's no like set standard answer and one solution fits all type of a model here, right? So you have to always go back to the beginning of this, which is, why are you in this journey, right? And if you ask most of them, they would probably say that, you know, we are doing it either for cost reasons, maybe we are doing this for business continuity reason, which is becoming far more important, especially in industry like ours. But now we are thinking about work from anywhere, right? In a back office BPO IT industry, it was unheard of 18 months ago, but now we are able to reimagine that world and say, yeah, we can do that. And therefore, business continuity is a key factor. And the third factor really why one makes a decision is, you know, customer experience, right? Both internal and external. So if you have these as the goals and say, eventually we want to be a digital organization and we also want to be digital finance as a function, right? If you set that as a parameter for to judge, right, then you would fix your, I mean, you would then pick processes that are ripe for automation and implementing bots, right? And you would probably start the way Milind just explained, you know, you probably go effort intensive processes, but you can also go value intensive processes. Like, I would find tremendous value if people can assure me on control, compliance, etc. And as part of that, we also get cost benefit and we can free up people's time to be far more productive, right? If you can get that in a single box, that's great, right? Now, while doing that, you have to really play 3-4 years forward, saying that, hey, what can happen to your business? What can happen to your industry? And therefore, what's the right strategy for you to like implement a automation or a RPA mandate, right? Why would you invest in your own infrastructure, et cetera, and build all of that? You can always say, let's take one variable out, let's put everything on the cloud. So therefore, life is easy to manage, right? So you have to go thematic in terms of how do you manage change, right? Because end of the day, technology will change, business rules will change, people will change. So you have to say, what themes can we adopt? So cloud is a good theme to say. Second is, can we look at a process and say, these 7 rules will not going to change for the next 3-4 years. So let's just pick those and automate it, right? Frills around it can change, right? So therefore, pick themes and then go on implementing. And this is not like a one-time activity. You'll have to put some sort of a governance in place to say, can we do a stop check every 6 months and say where we are, what changes we need to make. And the good thing about, you know, implementing bots are these are easy to change also. If you got a template right, changing a couple of rules and adapting to change business environment is pretty easy, right? So I would say if you have a right governance mechanism, thematic approach in terms of what you want to do over the next 3-4 years, have a broad strategy in terms of why you're doing it, I think managing change itself is not that difficult.
Bharti, I want to come to you next. You know, I think Abhilasha touched upon the point about people fearing job losses on account of automation, and obviously that is a reality in some cases. And we've also seen organizations that invest a lot in terms of reskilling people. So tell us your own experience in terms of, you know, how people were able to migrate from one to maybe a high skilled kind of a job role later once automation sort of kicked in.
Yeah, thanks, Ima. See, I would like to answer this in two parts. First, in terms of it's actually slightly addressed that one of the risks which is also existing in any of the automation process, which I have experienced at least when I was doing this automation process. While we discussed about what kind of person will be the best person to lead the project and who will be the best team members, but I have always seen a dedicated team is always better to do the IT automation. And once the project is go live and kicked off, we see a great urgency in pulling out these resources before it is properly diluted across the organization and is penetrating across all levels. There is a great urgency for us to go live immediately, and we expect magic in 1 year. And we straight away start pulling out these resources who are implementation. That hand-holding phase has to be definitely there. That is one of the biggest risks that we see, that the kind of analysis we put in terms of getting the return out of this IT initiatives, we really don't monitor after implementation whether it has actually we are able to reap the benefits. Because the most of the problem happens because we pull out the resources immediately on ground as if everything got modified and smooth. Yeah. That should be always there. The idea should not be immediately take out the cost benefits by controlling people and pulling out the resource. That is one thing which I see as a risk which people should be aware when they are doing any automation project. As far as reskilling the existing groups, again, there are two parts. There are certain processes which will obviously lead to a kind of reduction in manpower, especially these large, big volume kind of jobs. Normally, I see it happening in the billing cycle, whereby there you can't really avoid. It will kind of lead to a reduction in manpower. But there are certain processes where I have seen that it really releases the time for this particular resource for reskilling. One example I could say is this payment to procurement cycle. When you really pull out these resources out of this whole stuff, you really can get them into a more of a business partnering role. We have seen we have used them more towards doing analysis kind of work for the business leaders here. Mm. Especially when it is a mid-sized firm, you will not be able to automate some of the MIS dashboards and some of the analytical source for a simple reason that these big size firms will not be having that much budget to really implement a big data analytics kind of project. Neither right. It will have so much of voluminous data as well. So this reskilling has really happened in this way, moving from a accountant role to a business partnering role, especially from a more of an analytical person than just a person who is doing a processing work. That is one right. Reskilling which I have seen happening in the finance department. And similarly, we have seen people, especially in litigation managers and compliance management, earlier most of the time went only in copy-pasting the same data to different people, keeping in different servers. This compliance and litigation management is one thing which many people don't really get into. It's very easy to say automation in a procurement cycle or in a billing cycle. But this is one area which really release of those redundant work every time you have to take out the data. Can put real some nice controls, and then people can act on the non-compliance rather than just understanding what is the non-compliance. So that is one area where we can really use the resources efficiently instead of just taking out the data every time.
Interesting. Yeah. Praveen, I want to come to you next. Tell us what are some of the imperatives for an automation success, especially within the finance function, because we are, you know, talking especially focused around finance as a process. So tell us, what are some of the imperatives, what's worked for you? And we'll also get Milan to sort of add on to it.
Yeah, thank you, Seema, and good afternoon to the rest of the speakers. I'll highlight that in maybe 4 or 5 points, and I'm really happy that some of the points which I thought I will discuss is already been highlighted by some of the members here. But I think that is showing something we are all thinking on a same line. So the first of all, I want to touch upon that the objective of the automation to be clear, and I believe it cannot be the cost reduction cannot be the paramount priority. It can be one of the reason, maybe 5-6, but it cannot be the first priority, because at least in the initial years, it has to be the process standardization, error-free reporting, then quality of the output that is coming out from the process that we are operating. I think this has to be the main objective while we going to implement the RBA when we start. So I think that has to be clear, and some of the speakers already highlighted that point, and I think that is a very valid point. And as far as for us also, I think that is one thought process we had. And while we implementing the RPA in our process, we could see that some of the process getting automated. The reports that is coming out is exceptionally good compared to a manual work that has been used to do. And what I see is that I have a almost 80% reduction in the audit queries that is coming out of certain functions. So I think that is where, especially being in the finance sector and industry from a finance sector, I think where we handle the cash and everything, the reporting becomes paramount important. So I think that is one key aspect. Second one, I think we need to continue to focus on the human resource. Because whatever process we automate, ultimately the process automated need to work along with the human resource, because we cannot completely remove the human element from whatever process we do automate, because there will be exceptions, there will be additional activities, etc. need to be done and performed. And even on the output also, we need to do some analysis on the output that is coming from the RPA. So I think the human element should be considered, and we need to have more focus on the human element. And in our case, I have a cubicle where one person is sitting doing a work, and next to him is a bot, which is nobody sitting there, and he can definitely have a thought process that maybe next day he his job also might lose, and that fear can always be there. But we need to educate the staff also before we are not looking at replacing the human resource or the people right now, maybe to bring out more work balance, because some of the people may be working very late in the day, in the night, etc. So that will bring some easiness on their work. There will be a work-life balance for the staff, etc. I think that is also very key, so that they also put their maximum effort to ensure that your automation process is a success. These are the two major areas. And maybe to add to that, one thing is that we need to have a frequent review of the process. So so for example, we handle a lot of bank accounts, and there is a reconciliation that is an automated process for us in Muthoot Micro. So what happens is that over a period of time, there is a change in software, password required. There can be an OTP process coming in the bank side, etc., which we may tend to lose. So we need to review it very frequently, whether the process is happening on a proper manner, and we can maybe set a target, like certain process we do currently, it may be automated 50%, we can have set a target to increase to 60%, 70%, etc. So I think that can bring a lot more, the automation process can be a lot more successful. Yeah. Adding to that, I think you need to have a scalable model, not only in the finance. I think Milan already covered that process, where a lot of the HR to finance function or the finance to outside is all manual work. And if we can bring some of the HR process also into an automated process, and the bot also can be utilized maximum. So if one bot, a particular function can work for an hour, then you can add another. So the efficiency of the bot also is very important for a successful model, because otherwise we just keep adding bot and the cost as well associated with it, but without having an effective utilization of the process. So you need to keep adding the process, you need to expand the model. And since it include lot of departments like HR, finance, IT, etc. I think it has to be a strategic decision. It has to come from the highest strategic decision making body of the organization. Then only it becomes a successful all across the department. So I think these are the 4-5 points from my side with respect to the RP successful. So when I talk about Muthoot Microfin, it has been a successful journey for us so far. I think we are focusing on these 4-5 points. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks so much, Praveen. I think, every person here has sort of talked or touched upon a little around regulatory and compliance impact. So tell us, how do you see the regulatory requirements and compliance getting impacted by RPA? So anybody who wants to go with that question.
See, for us, we are a NYSE listed company. So SOX is a major issue for us, right? I mean, if you're not SOX compliant, then automatically we put all the stakeholders at risk. And these are both civil and criminal liabilities, right? Our board, our management, and all of them gets impacted. And SOX, as our friends on this call will know, it's highly evidence-intensive process, right? You need to show evidence. You need to show that how do you review? How do you collect data? Is the data sanctity protected? And so on and so forth, right? And then you demonstrate control, oversight, and stuff like that. So this requires significant amount of effort. And if you really go back and see each of the processes from a SOX perspective, at least we have seen that about 60-70% of the work that we do around SOX is all repetitive in nature. This repeats for by every quarter, it repeats every year. And all of that is also useful for reliance by your internal stakeholders as well as auditors and regulators, right? And therefore, if you can implement a very strong automation, bots, etc. into this process, you can significantly cut down the time required to collate, manage data, right? And using that, people can then do a lot of oversight, right? So therefore, without having effort reduction, you can actually reprioritize the effort in a manner that your oversight can be well demonstrated. And through that, you will achieve a much better level of compliance and giving much better confidence to markets as well as the stakeholders, right? And in the absence of that, of course, some of us will end up in prison, right? So therefore, the business case is right there, right? For you to say why this is so important. I just took SOX as an example, right? I mean, you can also implement that across many other functions, right? I mean, if you look at a typical MNC, right, which if you assume that, they operate in about 20-25 countries, right? The number of compliances that you need to manage between immigration, HR, tax, etc. will run in few thousands, right? And some of them will be standard, some of them will be unique, right? Based on the geography you're operating. For you to say which compliances actually you're doing, who's the owner of the compliances, are they kind of producing the records to give you the confidence that the compliance is met, etc. is a hugely effort-intensive project in the company, right? And therefore, ripe area for you to kind of, do some sort of standardization, implement tools that can actually automate it so that you can come to a level of dashboarding where a simple dashboard, red, yellow, green, tells you where you stand, and then you deep dive or double click into that and, start managing that better, right? So that's how I see, compliance as to why that is becoming like a focus and why I've heard compliance like 10 times on this call already as a ripe area for automation, etc. Yeah.
Right. Anybody wants to add to it?
Actually, yeah. Seema, to add an Indian context to this, especially there are so many returns which comes with the due dates, the GST, the income tax, and so many acts which are very specific to industries. This compliance dashboard comes very handy in managing due dates. So, especially listed companies and companies who are very particular that there should not be any non-compliances, it sets automatic reminders and it gives controls on whether it's matching with the financial data, the amount that has been paid and all those things. In that way, compliance is a very handy tool and which really helps in a lot more way.
Okay. Interesting. Anybody else wants to add to it?
Just to add on, I think colleagues have already said that, but I think the automation also helps in terms of the qualitative compliance. It's not only what you are, it's not only the tick in the box, but what is the level of compliance which is being done is also very important, which the entire automation process can manage and give that kind of assurance.
Right, thanks. Amit, you had a point?
Just making a related point only that, look, the good thing about compliance is that pretty much everything is standard and there are rules to it. There are standard formats. So it's easier to do automation through RPA or some other kind of automation So the team who's responsible for the compliance can actually focus more on the quality of the data rather than just getting the data and everything together, right? That's why all the more reason, and compliance is seen as a unnecessary overhead, right? For finance teams to do it. They have to do it because they have to do it. You know, they don't see any kind of real benefit of doing it. There's a fear factor, right? So it's better to, so there are standards, there are rules, so better focus on quality rather than just getting the basics together, right?
Right. Yeah, thanks. Milind, I want to go to you next. You know, we've sort of covered different aspects of RPA, what processes are right for automation, etc. But tell us, what does the future of RPA hold with respect to technologies like AI, ML, NLP, process analytics, etc.? And how will these technologies together aligned to meet the business needs of users?
I think I'll talk about the friction point. I think what everybody on this call said, and based on everybody said, the first 20-30 bots are easy. I mean, those are low hanging, and I'm sure every organization will start it. I think after that, you run into two frictions. And friction number one is that how do you go and find processes? You discover and you mine processes and do that. So I think the one way the RPA industry is evolving, including, you know, our platform, is that we start with something called as discovery process. So you put a bot, who mimics or monitors the human activity and identifies that, you know, every day this person does this eight tasks repeatedly, and that's a possible automation. The second, I think, is an element we did not touch on significantly, but I see is a big issue in India, is this entire data management we do. You know, irrespective of the business, you know, every company is in. If you are in real estate, you are getting lots of customer documents. You are in banking, you get Aadhaar, PAN, whatnot. If you are in insurance, you get lots and lots of data. And I think what happens today in many industries is that while it may not sit under finance, but finance has a big role in terms of controlling that cost. So, you know, how do you kind of integrate that PDFs, documents, emails, etc. is the second. And that's where, to your larger point, the AI and ML comes into play. Because if you have, you know, the same vendor supplying to you in a certain form, how do you kind of do that in an ML model and then cut down your time? And in the same bank you are consolidating with or reconciling with, and how do you kind of build an AI element to that? I think the third element which has come, and probably Praveen made that a very good point, that bots will also have to be managed and monitored from a productivity point of view, like the way we would do a human productivity. And I think that's another dimension which is being added. Where we see 2 years from now, or at least what we are working on as a company, are two aspects. One is the voice integration. Today, a lot of finance, internal or external interactions, has a lot of repetitive voice activities. So there is, hopefully in 2 years time, we'll be able to get that integration done and further kind of minimize the time. And then the other big technology which is kind of coming in is which has been talked about for many years but not been commercially deployed, is this entire plug and play seasonality. I think, you know, Bharti made that point that there are seasonal cycles. Month ends are very bad, quarter ends are bad, year ends are horrible, audit cycles are pretty bad, and so on. In finance domain, I think, and the compliance times, and, you know, I think Vikas really spoke very well about that. Can you really have variable workforce during that period? This concept was talked about 3 years back, but we did not have underlying cloud readiness. Now with cloud coming in and then certain service providers coming in, I do see that today what is offered to CFOs as a people-driven service, okay, I will put 10 people to do your GST filing. I do see that 2 years from now, particularly in India, you will have cloud-based service available, which you can kind of plug in, play in. So I know, again, a bigger answer, but the industry is heading in next few years.
Yeah, I think that's interesting to know because, organizations that have sort of embarked on this journey and have sort of completed one process, I think there is a lot that they would like to look forward to in terms of what is the opportunity scope going forward. So I think we've covered a lot of ground around RPA implementation within organization, what processes, how does it sort of map out, and, you know, post implementation, what are some of the challenges. So I think, before we close, I would like our speakers to sort of provide their closing comments. You have about 30 seconds each. So you need to tell us what would be your vision for advanced automation in finance. So we start with you first, Vikas.
Okay, yeah. I would say, one need to recognize that the role of CFO itself is evolving. It is changing big time. The way all of us used to operate maybe 3 years ago is now. And therefore, the routine, the mundane, and the repetition, all of that needs to be automated. That has to go out of your window, right? And that should not just go out of your window, it should go out of the entire team's window and the business itself, right? And in our world, we say, automation is not a choice anymore, right? It is an ask, right? So you have to go and make it happen and reprioritize your workforce in a manner that can deliver better customer experience. We use the word customer. So how do you deliver better customer experience, which actually then generates lot of value to the business, both internal and external, right? As long as you're managing that through a fairly automated process, you will free up a lot of bandwidth of the organization, right from the CEO till the last person, which can be redeployed in a much more productive manner, which can be efficiently used to deliver the outcomes that you're after. So that's how we kind of think about
it. Great. Anil?
Yeah, so I think we will look at complete digital transformation, clearly also, upgrading the people in terms of their knowledge, being clearly using these kind of, tools, being enabler for the business. And then actually enabling also focusing team more on analytics rather than doing mundane jobs.
Sure. Interesting. Abhilasha, what would be your vision for advanced automation in finance?
I think in our entire conversation that we had, we just touched base a little bit about the commercial finance, and this is one of the department where we start our sales from. And if we do not have the view on our SKUs and our customers, as Vikas said, that customer satisfaction is one of the key. If he is satisfied, then you win. In fact, 75% of the battle, 25% is managing your own processes and everything else. So I believe that, my automation idea would be, automizing all the ideas which increase the sales in terms of loyalty programs, in terms of, any way which can add to the sales and the customer satisfaction. That is my idea of automation.
Great. Venkat?
Yes. Actually, the AI and the cloud computing would be the order of the day in future. That is my opinion, because having seen a lot of data, particularly, how you can manage the complaints. I think a lot of people talked about the complaints also. And complaints means we are talking not just India because of the parent and subsidiary relationship. You can say antitrust laws of UK is applicable, anti-monopoly act of UK is applicable. So I think, as said by other people, we need to have the cloud computing and as well as AI, which will be the future for this.
Thanks. Amit
Agarwal? When we talk about digital transformation journey, the idea is to eliminate all the manual and repetitive tasks and digitize all those processes. And that is just a very low-hanging fruit, actually. Mm. So what we are trying to do here is to enhance the customer experience. Our focus to begin with is to, deploy all the tools which are available in digital transformation, which enhances the customer experience and customer engagement, actually. These are more front-facing, customer-facing. Then, of course, the productivity improvement, process improvement, all those things we are trying to capture. The other thing what we are, data is a new oil, actually. There's a lot of data we have, but we are not able to capture data meaningfully, actually. All those analytics, data analytics, etc. Or we are trying to, deploy those tools to see how we capture data and we take a meaningful decision and improve our ROI. Yeah, I think.
Great.
Praveen?
Your closing comments?
So, coming from the BFSI sector, I think the demand or expectation from the investors or the regulators, I think that is getting changed. And the expectation with respect to the quality of the data and the quantity of the data, which is being sought by the investors or the bankers or the regulators themselves, I think it is changing. And without automation, I think you will be struggling to adapt to what is, because all across around you also it is getting changed. I think it is imperative that you need to move to automation pretty soon.
Sure, thanks. Amit Bedi?
Look, most of the stuff has been covered. I would say, look, the world was very different and you know, in last 10 years, the world is going to change a lot in next 10 years. So this whole bots and RPAs, this whole automation is inevitable. So embrace the change, right? So my vision is basically upskill and reskill yourself and your team members. Focus on the quality of the finance stuff which you have been doing, and have a meaningful top line and bottom line impact on the business, right?
Sure, thanks. So Milan, would you sort of close for us in terms of what your closing comments and would be?
I think, very good discussions. Pretty much we covered the ground. I would simply say that cloud is an interesting area for not just for automation but for finance leaders to look at, and particularly in India it has really reached maturity now, and you know, I think Praveen's from the banking industry, so he can really educate everybody more that how cloud has taken center stage. And second, I would say that ability to read and capture all the semi-structured and unstructured data. I think, you know, Amit made that point that, you know, MIS, etc. How do you kind of leverage that? So probably, you know, keep automation as a kind of that starting point. But then if you kind of integrate this two, that leads to better efficiency and effectiveness of finance. And, you know, that the core role of finance, which is not just value protection, but value creation, I think is kind of gets into the center stage.
Thank you so much. I think very interesting comments, insights that have come in. So with that, we come to the end of today's discussion. A big thank you to our contributors, Anil Randher, Abhilasha Sharma, Vikas Sureka, A. Venkatraman, Amit Bedi, T. Praveen, Amit Agarwal, Bharti Karnanidhi, and Milan Seth, for sharing your insights and experience with us and for helping us advance the discussions around automation and RPA in this series. And I look forward to seeing you all at another interesting session soon. So until then, take care and stay safe. Thank you all very much.